See, that without a central approval cannot happen, and also the amount stated there will eventually either be resolved or resolved in favor of the authorities, and therefore the tax will be paid or the claim will be settled, but the amount shall be what was claimed and not more or less. And this will be available for the assessor himself to see it, so that he knows what he is being asked. If necessary, he can even quote that and complain, so that there are no anomalies in paper and actual practice. So this is one way in which we think the harassment angle can be addressed in favor of the assessee. The second, any communication issued without computer-generated unique document identification number, the DIN number, that shall be treated non-est. In other words, if anybody has issued from his own level at the ground level, that notice shall not be treated. Actually, the assessee can put it aside and say, I've not received any note. Nobody is going to follow him up. Unless the notice goes through the central clearance, and unless the notice has a DIN number, the document identification number, it need not be taken seriously by any assessee at all. So let's make that very clear. And all old notices, the question naturally arises, you announce this, what happens to those which were given earlier? All old notices to be decided by 1st October 2019 or uploaded again through the system. So all the notices which have been issued till now will be cleared before October 1st, 2019, within 1.5 months from now. And if in case some of them will have to be treated again, they'll be uploaded again, and only then will it become a valid document for action. So assessees can be very clear, it is now a transparent process. No one authority, no one officer will be doing it independently on his own. And then from 1st October 2019, all notices to be disposed of. This is very important. Things are not going to keep hanging fire. All notices to be disposed of within 3 months from the date of reply. Let's be clear, no assessee will have anything to do with any notice after 3 months once he's given a reply. So that's on the first silo of respecting and honoring our wealth creators. We shall go through a very transparent process. The next one is on the taxation measures that we are coming up with. The much awaited
May I click, madam?
Yes, please. Relief from enhanced surcharge on long-term and short-term capital gains. In order to encourage investment in the capital market, it has been decided to withdraw the enhanced surcharge levied by the Finance No. 2 Act of 2019, the recent budget time, on long and short-term capital gains arising from transfer of equity or shares and units referred in Section 11A and 111A and 112A respectively. In other words, the enhanced surcharge on FPI goes, in simple words. In other words, the pre-budget position is restored. Surcharge on domestic investors too in the equity market goes. Pre-budget position is restored. So, can we go to the next? Or do you want to hear, you don't want to hear anything more?
Yes, ma'am, or not?
No, no, we are going on the other this also. Okay, now, I'm using an expression which is used commonly, but it's not something part of the ministry. Things about angel tax provisions. That's not an official expression for the tax that we're referring to, but never mind, all of us understand what angel tax refers to. So to mitigate genuine difficulties of startups and their investors, it has been decided that Section 56(2)(b) of the Income Tax Act shall not be applicable to a startup registered with DPIIT. So the section which is invoked and through which startups had difficulties. But that section is important for the income tax for many other reasons, so the section continues, but that section shall not be applicable to registered startups. All right, now this is done, but after this, if there's a difficulty, it has also been decided to set up a dedicated cell under a member of the CBDT. The CBDT chairman is here, present in the audience. A member of the CBDT will head a cell under him for addressing the problems of startups. A startup having any income tax issue can approach the cell for quick resolution of the problems. So that way, we have one, made it clear that it shall not apply to startups who are registered with the Department of Industry and Internal Trade. Not only that, but further, there will be a member who will be handling it from the CBDT. We move to the next, which is my third silo, which relates to measures that we are coming up with for the banks, for NBFCs, and for MSMEs. Additional credit expansion through public sector banks. This is something which we did announce during the budget session. Upfront, we are releasing the 70,000 crores. Upfront, we are releasing the 70,000 crores and additional lending and liquidity to the tune of 5 lakh crores can be made available by providing this upfront capital for the PSPs. This was announced in the budget. We are doing it upfront now. And this will, we are very clear that this will benefit all the corporates, retail borrowers, MSMEs, and small traders as well. So we'll also tell you that we are closely working out the ways in which this flow will happen, how it will flow through the NBFCs and so on in a later slide. But this is the first one which we want to tell you. Next. Banks have been discussing with us. You know that the first discussion one Monday happened with the banks only. Banks have now decided to pass on any rate cut through the MCLR reduction to benefit all borrowers. It's a decision which the banks have made. I'm very grateful because during the consultation, we emphasized on the total, irrespective of the segments, people saying that the benefits of rate reduction don't reach them at all. Or if it reaches, it reaches in trickles. Or if it reaches, the trickles last over several months and years. So there was this across-the-board grievance that interest rates not being passed down to the customer is affecting, in spite of Reserve Bank having brought it down several times. So now we are very grateful all the banks have agreed, and they said that they shall pass on the rate. The next one is, this is more important, and that will explain the previous point that I've made. Banks, again, have decided to launch repo rate or external benchmarking linked loan products. Only a few days ago, the governor of Reserve Bank had spoken about it. He was talking about institutionalizing this mechanism, was also still hoping that the banks would work on it. Now, banks have agreed to do this, and I really want to put on record my appreciation of the finance secretary, who has been sitting and engaging with the banks to convince them that today's environment demands that the banks become a bit more reasonable on this, and this will therefore result in reduced EMI for housing loans, vehicles, and other retail loans by directly linking repo rate to the interest rates, which means the moment the reduction has happened, it will directly benefit the customers, end customers. Working capital loans for industry will also become cheaper as a result. Go over to the next, customer ease. In order to reduce harassment and bring in greater efficiency, public sector banks shall ensure mandated return of loan documents within 15 days of loan closure. Most often, people who came and spoke to us said, look, we finished the loan, we've brought it to a closure, but our documents, the security related documents, are not being given to us. It was a demand of every segment which met with us during the consultation, and therefore we've worked together with public sector banks and come to today's situation where within 15 days of the closure of the loan, the documents will be given to the customers so that he can do anything else with it afterwards. It shall now not be held unreasonably by the banks. So this will benefit all those customers who have mortgage documents in the banks and they are sitting without being able to release them. I go to the next point, again under the banks and NBFCs, again on the customer ease, online tracking of loan applications by customers of retail, MSME, housing, vehicle, working capital, limit enhancements, all of this will be covered. They can track it themselves online. So there's no need for them to wonder, saying the application made, nothing has turned up, we don't know where it is lying. You track it like we would do with a courier parcel, I suppose, as to where it goes at which stage. So this would increase transparency, reduce harassment. There shall not be a need for people to go knock at different doors to say, where's my loan application? And this will also improve the turnaround time for customers. The next is talking about banks to issue improved transparent OTS policy, one-time settlement policy, to benefit MSME. This is not theoretical. This is not an abstraction. We are not just saying, oh, banks will improve transparency. How will they do it? For settlement of one-time loans or one-time loan settlements, we are approaching it with a checkbox approach. If a client has complied with certain requirements in a one sheet of paper, use a checkbox system and there and then settle for the one-time settlement, rather than say somebody else will have to take a call, we'll have to pass the paper on to somebody else and come back and waste time. If the checkbox approach is taken up by MSMEs and they go about ticking the box and giving it to the banks, there's no reason somebody else should come to decide the matter. The banks can there and then decide and clear the one-time settlements which are due. Because many of the NPAs or many of these accounts which are waiting for banks to take a call are waiting because nobody wants to take this call. Nobody wants to take a decision on the one-time settlement. There are many other points which I'll add to say, why will an official in a bank now feel encouraged to do it? We've taken adequate steps also to make sure that there shall not be any harassment of the official for the risk that he's taking, because the formulation is as per the checkbox ticking. So that way we expect to have a lot of quick one-time settlements clearing out of the bank's books. The next one is the one which I elaborated. In order to protect decision-making, honest decision-making, because the inputs which are coming are for fear of action, many of those honest decision-makers in banks are not able to go forward to take a call because they don't know what is involved in the decision-making, and therefore there is a stagnation in decision-making in banks. We are now making sure that stagnation, that worry, that aversion to risk-taking are all being removed. So in order to support decision-making and to prevent harassment for genuine commercial decision by bankers, the CBC has issued directions that internal advisory committee, the IAC, in banks to classify cases as vigilance and non-vigilance. Decision on the by the IAC and bank chief vigilance officers or the DAs to be treated as final. So because that happens there and then, decision taking risk will not be anymore laden in their heads, so we expect that will protect honest decision-making in the banks. We move to the next point under banks, NBFCs and MSMEs. More credit support for purchase of houses, vehicles and for consumption goods. How are we doing this? Additional liquidity support for HFCs, home finance corporations, for rupees 20,000 crores by the National Housing Bank, and thereby increasing it to 30,000 crores, which is an increase which we are making now. Partial credit guarantee scheme for purchase of pooled assets of NBFCs and housing finance corporations up to 1 lakh crore to be monitored at the highest level in each of the banks. So NHBs have already settled some issues. As we are announcing this, some of them have already been settled, very clearly showing the NBFCs are receiving liquidity from the banks, and the NBFCs are also moving towards funding of people, giving credits to people. Examples shall be out by late evening today. Some of them will come for you all to double check that this is indeed started moving. And therefore, the NHB related increase in funding from 20,000 crore to 30,000 crore is sure to make a difference, because we've already started moving in that direction, and examples will be available for all of us. Partial credit guarantee scheme, which I've already explained, and that shall be monitored at the highest level, that was announced during budget. RBI has also come out with its notification on it. Through this, we expect many of the assets will get quickly pooled and NBFCs will receive the necessary liquidity. The prepayment notices issued to NBFCs will be monitored by the banks. We move over. To the next point, which is NBFCs will now be permitted to use Aadhaar authenticated bank KYC to avoid repeated processes. Because many of the people who came for consultation said what has been proved once is now being repeatedly asked by another agency and a third one and so on. So now what we've said is clearly that Aadhaar can be authenticated by the banks through the KYC, and NBFCs need not ask for one more time proving and repeating the process. This will simplify and quicken up the taking of credit. So this was a major demand by the NBFCs, and therefore we have ensured that we've given them this benefit. The necessary changes have also been made in the PMLA rules for this. Aadhaar regulations have also been tweaked to this extent. Then this will enable a easier and faster tracking, onboarding of customers, we think. Another very important fact, all of you all would probably know, quick summary would be, banks are sitting with liquidity, NBFCs have the reach, but this money is not moving to the NBFCs, and as a result, NBFCs are not able to forward credit. This has been the overall simple summary of the situation. What we've now done is to take advantage of the liquidity that which is with the PSPs and the last mile consumer connect that the NBFCs have, so that PSBs can fast track collaboration for loans, particularly to the MSME. So the co-origination is the rules or the requirements of the banks will apply even in the context of an NBFC where the requirement probably do not exist or are harsher. So this will work together and bring in the synergy between the NBFCs and the banks, so that where the NBFCs are present, the banks' advantages will reach them, and where there are no NBFCs, the banks themselves can push it forward. And therefore, the synergy, we think, will help in reaching out the end customer quickly with the liquidity which is sitting with the PSBs and the NBFCs, which are nicely spread and available everywhere. So the co-origination is a very important measure, which even the RBI has gone through, and we are convinced that it's going to work to the favor of the customers. The most important thing again, GST refunds for MSMEs. This was rampantly heard from a lot of MSMEs saying, our refunds are stuck, we are not sure when we will get it, will you give it? Now, I would want all of you all to please hear this out clearly. This is clearly time bound now. All pending GST refunds due to MSMEs till now, that is, shall be paid within 30 days. Everything that is pending since I don't know how many years from the time of introduction, let us say, of the GST, from then till today, whoever has got a pending refund problem, it will be sorted out within 30 days from today. The government has worked very clearly to clear it all within 30 days. And from now, for future GST refunds, every refund for future GST refund matters will be sorted out within 60 days after it arises. For those which are pending till now, irrespective of 1 year, 6 months, 8 months, whatever, we commit ourselves to clear it within 30 days. And from now, anything which arises newly, within 60 days, the refund for MSMEs will be done so that the MSMEs are not worried about money being stuck somewhere and they not getting it. So that's cleared. The next one, TREDS, you are aware of. Many of these companies are registered under TREDS, and the Prime Minister had very clearly announced, once I recall, that being in TREDS, if there are large companies who owe money to the MSMEs, and if they were in TREDS, that system enabled them, the moment they got into it, that they could discount their bills and get the money, even if the company delayed it. TREDS enabled that. Now what we are telling is, for those companies which are registered and a part of the GST, if TREDS uses the GSTN facility, and for every bill that is certified or signature obtained under the GST, the same discounting will be available even for MSMEs, so they need not worry that GST paid, we paid GST tax, but we are not getting the payment from that company who owes us, for whom the supply has been made. So that company's money can now be obtained because the bank will honor the moment the GSTN signature is on it, and MSMEs will be benefiting similarly as many companies benefit out of TREDS. Now, TREDS and GSTN are working together. They can obtain information, and therefore the MSMEs can quickly discount their bills and get the money for their requirement. The next one is a point on MSME definition. That's been one of the worries of MSMEs who approached us. A single definition would serve them better rather than several definitions existing in different acts. So what we have committed here is the MSME Act. In fact, the discussions when it happened, Mr. Nitin Gadkari ji was seated with us even as the consultation happened, and this issue was repeatedly raised. We are addressing that issue because the MSME Act will now go to the cabinet with inputs taken from all of the ministries concerned, just so there is one definition, one meaningful definition, which probably may not necessarily link it only to turnover, but might take plant and machinery and the optimal capacity and everything else on board and come up with one definition for MSME, through which companies now can feel a lot more at ease with their business activity. So that sooner will go to the cabinet. The UK SINA committee has come up with a lot of recommendations, many of which are already on board. We have taken it up, and we are already in fact, some of the suggestions that we've done here for the MSMEs are partly covered by the UK SINA committee. We shall ensure decisions on recommendations, such as on ease of credit, marketing, technology, delayed payments, etc., are all addressed at the earliest. So I want to assure you that many of them have already become a part of what we are speaking about today, but others in the UK SINA committee report will be taken up. The next we move over to.
देश दुनिया की हर छोटी बड़ी खबरों पर इंडिया वॉच की पैनी नजर, अब हर खबर आपके मोबाइल पर, सब्सक्राइब नाउ. दुनिया की हर छोटी बड़ी खबरों पर इंडिया वॉच की पैनी नजर, अब हर खबर आपके मोबाइल पर, सब्सक्राइब नाउ.